Hi, I am Shreyas, Applications Engineer supporting Logic and Translation Business Unit at TI. I'll be talking about some system-level challenges and provide insight into how logic devices can simplify your system. Here are the topics discussed in the presentation. First, we will be covering a brief overview of the standard logic portfolio. Next, we will understand the internal CMOS structure of a typical logic gate, discuss some of the most common questions related to the input, output, and overall functioning of the device. Next, we will see examples of system-level solutions and common application use cases using logic and translation devices. We will tie this common use cases back to the building block initiative for various automotive, industrial, enterprise communications, and personal electronics and equipment reference designs and system block diagrams. Standard logic product line has five main families. All the families are used in almost all the sectors, namely industrial, automotive, personal electronics, enterprise, and communications. Now let's see the families in detail. Number one is the voltage translation. Underneath it, we have the direction control translation, auto bidirectional translation, application specific, and translating gate subfamilies. Some of the popular device families include TXS, TXB, AVC, LVC, and the newly released AXE family. Gates and buffers. All the common gates, including AND, NAND, NOR, OR, XOR, XNOR, as well as the inverting and non-inverting buffers are the subfamilies. Popular devices among them are LVC, AUP, and AUC. FFLR and multi-gates. The subfamilies include higher channel count buffers, gates, flip-flops, latches, shift registers. Popular devices include AHC595, LV125, AHC21. Number four, specialty logic. The subfamilies, which include monostable multivibrators, combinational logic, digital comparators, counters, timers, digital PLLs, adders, and other miscellaneous items. Some of the popular devices include LVC1G123, HC192, HC4060, etc. Number five is the transceivers, encoders, decoders. This includes standard transceivers, registered transceivers, buffered encoders, and decoders. Popular devices include AHC245, AHC253, AHC138, etc. Let us now try to understand the internal CMOS structure taking NAND gate as an example. The NAND gate's functional table is as shown and is represented by AB bar. Although this is a digital circuit, the internal structure is analog in nature. The A and B are the inputs with the positive and negative ESD structures. Sometimes the positive ESD diodes may not exist, but there is always a negative ESD structure present at all the pins of the device. The Y is the output with the push-pull structure as shown here with the positive and negative ESD structure as well. The code gate logic is shown here at the center. All the true inputs are marked here with the blue arrow. It could be the channel select pins, the clock pins, clear, preset, D input pins, or the input pins for the gates. All the input will either be buffered or unbuffered without an inverting stage at the beginning. The most common technology standards are CMOS and TTL, which stands for transistor-transistor logic. Here is a representation for the input-output voltage levels for these technology standards. The I/O levels can vary between each standard and for different VCC levels, and hence the same 1 volt, for example, can be interpreted as a low or can be interpreted as a high or neither, depending on the technology standard and the VCC levels. VIL is the maximum input voltage applied such that the device recognizes it as a low. VIH is the minimum input voltage applied, which the device recognizes as a high. VT is the threshold voltage where the device switches from low to high or high to low. Take one example here for a 5 volt TTL and 5 volt CMOS. The figure on the right is the graphical representation of the bar. VT is 1.5 volts for TTL as compared to 2.5 volts or half the VCC for CMOS. For 5 volts TTL, 0.8 volts is the VIL, whereas for 5 volts CMOS, the VIL is 1.5 volts, represented here in the green arrow. With the voltage below VIL, the N-channel PFET is off and the P-channel PFET is on, and the output is at VCC. The VIH is 2 volts for TTL, whereas it is 3.5 volts for CMOS, represented in the blue arrow. With the voltage above VIH, the P-channel FET is off and the N-channel FET is on, and the output is at ground. Except for the leakage current of the FET, there is no time when there is a direct path from VCC to ground. However, there is a forbidden region where the voltage level is beyond VIL and below VIH. This is the region where both NFET and PFET are partially turned on, resulting in shoot-through current. Note that the VT, or the threshold voltage for CMOS, is about VCC by 2, and this is where the ICC current is at its peak. The datasheet also specifies delta ICC spec, which by definition is the additional amount of supply current consumed when any one of the inputs is not at the supply rails, which is either VCC or ground. Let us now look into some of the use cases. Usually, system has multiple power rails, and the processor needs to enable the operation only when all the supplies are up and stable. Logic gates help in combining multiple power rails output into a single enable input to the processor. Depending on the application, we can use AND gates when there is active high enable power good inputs and active high enable to the processor, or use NAND gate for active high inputs but active low enable, or NOR gates for active low inputs and active high enable, or the OR gate, which could be used for active low inputs and active low enable. Similar concept can be applied for selective gating or enabling using AND gate. Popular devices include LVC1G08, AUP1G00, which is the NAND gate, AHC1G32, which is the OR gate. Combining error signals. Similarly, OR gate can be used to combine active high error signals and enable certain remedial action. It could be an error from a peripheral, or a thermal error, or a power supply error. It can combine the signals into a single output and feed the reset or interrupt or activate a buzzer or emergency turn off the system. Depending on the system application, different gates can also be used for this. Popular devices include AHC1G32, LVC1G32, LVC32A Q1. XOR gate is a basic component of phase lock loop circuits. It compares the incoming clock frequency and compares it with an internally generated reference clock signal to generate a pulse width, which is based on the phase difference of the two signals. The output is then fed to the input of the voltage controlled oscillator after filtering. The figure on the right is another use case for XOR gate. Here, the incoming single-ended PWM signal is converted to a differential signal, that is, which has an inverted and non-inverted portion of the PWM signal. Typically, the incoming signal will be passed as it is, and an inverter needs to be used to generate the PWM bar signal, causing phase difference between the two, which is not ideal. Since the two XOR gates are from the single package, the advantage of this implementation is the minimal skew and phase difference between the inverted and the non-inverted signal. Examples of the XOR gate include LVC1G86, AUC1G86, which are the single gate versions, LVC2G86, AUC2G86, which are the dual gate versions. Sometimes there are cases where different devices in the system operates and outputs at different voltage nodes. Is it safe to apply different voltages to a logic device? What happens when the input voltage is higher than the logic supply voltage? Will it damage the device and the system operation? And what is the solution? The answer is, it depends. Recall, I had talked earlier about the positive and negative ESD clamp diodes during the CMOS input structure discussion. The presence of positive clamp diodes is indicated by the APSMAX rating table in the datasheet. When input voltage range is independent of VCC, the device doesn't have positive clamp diodes, and hence can tolerate higher input voltage than the supply. However, if the positive clamp diodes are present, the rating will either mention VCC plus 0.5 or something similar. Clamp current ratings in the datasheet is another indication of the presence or absence of positive clamp diodes. As seen here, the input clamp current ratings has a maximum current of minus 50 milliamps with input voltage less than zero, indicating that the positive clamp diodes are absent. Based on this, inputs at 3.3 volts and 5 volts to an AND gate operating at 2.5 volts supply can be given, and the output is clamped to the supply voltage, effectively acting as a down translation device. What happens when there are unused inputs in the CMOS circuit? Recap from the earlier slides about the shoot-through current when the input voltage is around the threshold region. When there are unused CMOS inputs, then there is a possibility that it can float to a value around the threshold region, which is about VCC by 2, and hence could result in very high quiescent ICC current. This could result in higher junction temperature within the die and could also lead to potential reliability issues in the long run. What is the easiest solution to this? We can tie the inputs to a known voltage, either ground or the supply rail, and maintain the ICC current to acceptable low value. Are there any other ways to utilize the unused inputs? Here, the NAND gates on the left have been used as an inverting buffer with the A and B inputs shorted together. Similarly, OR gates or AND gates can be used as a non-inverting buffer with A and B inputs shorted together. This may substitute the need for a separate buffer or an inverter, helping save BOM costs and the board space.